It's another episode of Wearable Today. I'm Batman, and welcome to the Halloween month edition of Wearable Today, where we talk about Weartech and your next wearable device. Today, we're going to be talking about your pets getting wearables and the ever-growing population of two four-legged creatures that are getting that, and I don't know if Birdie's got that, but we'll be talking about that. We're going to be talking about feeling lonely and how wearables can help on that. Five pieces of Weartech that came before Weartech was even coined, and a whole bunch more. This is another episode of our fabulous episode number 86, Secure SSL Access Error of Wearable Today. Hey everybody, Jeffrey Powers from Geekazine Think Magazine. Put in a geek, and you've got Batman. I'm Batman, and my wearable tech for the Halloween season. And of course, Luke. There you are, Mr. Luke Wallace.
What are you saying, man? Hey everybody, Luke Wallace here. Luke on Twitter. And, it's over on this side.
Yeah.
You can find me on Twitter at Luke Luca or Google+, google.com/plusLukeWallace, or for this show, luke@wearabletoday.com.
All right. And for those of you who don't know, he's wearing his Luke Skywalker helmet. And if you want to get a reference, take a look at this. Okay, here's Luke. And here's Luke. And here's Luke. And here's Luke. Luke's not wearing the plaid in this one.
Yeah.
With plaid shirt. Without plaid shirt. Without the trees. With the trees. No Ewoks. Ewoks. You get the idea. So, anyway, let's move on. Let's get into our big news. Little arms.
Can wearables remove the feeling of loneliness? That was the goal of one team at TechCrunch Disrupt, who created a wearable app that connects two users anonymously. Those users can then connect with text and emoji. It's only a proof of concept right now, but the designers want users to feel a strong bond between strangers, even if they'll never know who the other person is.
You know, because we all hide behind our smartphones and stuff like that, so you'll never know who somebody is. They could be Batman or Luke or something like that.
Yeah, it could be pretty much anybody.
Exactly. All right, well, besides connecting with strangers, wearables can also help you connect with yourself. Not that way. The next web profiles five pieces of Weartech that can help track breathing, heart rate, posture, and even your yoga workout. Interesting. They walk through the pros and cons of each and outline pricing, but who can really put a price on inner peace? Namaste.
Was Weartech just that before Weartech existed? We look at five pieces of Weartech that existed before it was a thing. From the reputer to the Walkman, calculator watches, Bluetooth headsets, and even a 3D display that never really took off, you can read about the technology that led to our modern Weartech. That's over at a website I've heard of. It's called Wearable Today.
.net?
No, .com.
Oh, I've never heard of it. Is that a new website?
It's kind of new. You probably haven't heard of it. Pretty cool.
Well, you know, I'm doing the crime fighting thing, so it's tough for me to go online when I'm trying to get the bad guys. You know, it's
just I'm out playing with teddy bears, so I got all the time in the world.
Yeah, it's teddy bears and speeder bikes.
Yep, cruising
with teddy bears.
Doesn't sound right.
Speaking of which, an opinion piece over on Recode.net from Lauren Good, who is the senior editor of The Verge. She outlines why Weartech is just getting started, which we all know about. I mean, we're in the infancy of Weartech. Early devices like Fitbit are leading to more sophisticated data monitoring devices, and user interactions are getting easier through the voice commands. As these technologies do advance, Weartech will be smaller, it'll be more common, and it'll be a lot easier to use. In fact, you might not even touch it during the day and use it throughout the day. Recode shares a video interview with Good where she discussed more of the barriers to wider adoption and where devices can improve. And the biggest thing, the biggest question is, will a device ever get implanted? And which I think in the next 5-10 years will be a thing where, you know, somebody will get a screen in your arm or something like that, and you'll have a motion tattoo, but it's not your skin, it's your screen. So interesting stuff. Yeah. Check it out over on Recode. And Birdie's wondering why she's not there.
Yeah, well, Birdie's not here tonight because she really doesn't like this hat. So she would not be able to sit still. She'd either be attacking it or fleeing. So she has to be back in her cage, which she is not a big fan of right now.
So. Well, you know, maybe we'll escape her out of her cage in a few minutes. But let's finish through the news here.
Sure. Back to the big news. So this is a quick update on an article we told you about back in May. We talked about how Tog Heuer was working on a $1,400 Android Wear device. And now it looks like it's coming. Tog Heuer has put up a teaser page, which we've got here, with a countdown to November 9th. Tog Heuer Connected will be announced. We're not sure if that's the platform or the actual name of the device, but that's what they're saying. They're calling it Tog Heuer Connected. We're not sure if the original price will hold true, and there might be something different that'll make this device more tempting than the other Android Wear devices that are out there. We'll keep you guys updated as we get to that November 9th date.
Yeah, and of course they have the time countdown there, so we're not going to get too much. We could probably go through the rumors. But you know, it's not an Apple Watch, so there's not that many rumors out there for the Tog Heuer.
Mm-mm.
So, but you know where there are rumors for. It's for that little thing called the Apple Watch. All right, we're over on a site called Alphr, ALPHR. And we're talking about rumors, features, specs, the release date, possibility. Of course, the biggest thing, you know, Apple Watch, second generation Apple Watch, will definitely be faster and will definitely be thinner and will definitely be have a better battery in it. Whether it has a camera in it or not is one of the big questions. A lot of people do want the camera. I'm not sure why. I think it's because of the FaceTime, and I think if they do it, they're gonna have one pointing at you, not pointing this way, so you could do this, taking your picture. I take your picture, but so you'd be like this, so you'd have to do this to take a picture, and it really doesn't work unless you're Batman, or I suppose that would work, but it'd be upside down. So figure it out and go from there. So, but a lot of other stuff. What have you seen from reading this article? What's the one thing that's kind of stepped out? Because it's all rumors.
It's all rumors. One thing they mentioned, and maybe if we talk it out, it'll make sense, but file transfers through getting close to somebody and like shaking their hand while you're both wearing an Apple Watch,
okay,
and then you can transfer something back and forth. It reminds me of Bump, where you could transfer files to another device. You both had Bump and you said, okay, ready to bump, and you would just kind of bump the phones together and it would know, hey, there's these two devices that both have Bump in the same approximate area and they just both registered a bump. Let me transfer the file back and forth.
Would it be more of a something for the business card thing or something for an actual file transfer?
It might be like a contact that could transfer. That would make a little more sense to me. Of like, oh, nice to meet you. Hey, look, we're both wearing Apple Watches. That means we just swapped contact information, even though I didn't really want to. Great. You know, like I would wonder, like, seems like you're still going to want to have to do something.
Yeah.
It's not going to be you wouldn't want to just anybody you shake hands with.
Yeah, I don't know if Apple would be too keen on that idea, because then there can be some sort of data transfer and security breach there. I mean, yeah. we could do the bump right now. Let's do the bump.
Oh, other side. Way.
Here you go. Bump. Wow, you have a big fist there. So, but and no data transferred. So, and I can't do this in no bird. So,
yeah,
but the whole point is that that's a big security risk for somebody, especially if they start jailbreaking. And there's a jailbreak for phones or for watches now, right?
I'm not sure.
I believe there is.
Like, it wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah. And I suppose all you need is an app on your iPhone and jailbreak your iPhone for that, and so, you know, all of a sudden somebody's stealing your data or something like that. We just watched Jennifer and I just watched CSI Cyber, and they just had one where somebody was doing the stalking thing, and he definitely was pulling stuff from her phone, even though they encrypted the phone and everything like that, she still had an access to the outside world, and he found a way in. So even though some of the stuff they were talking about on the show was a little bit far-fetched, the reality is there that somebody can do something like that to get into there. So I just don't see this. I see this as something that'd be nice for like a card transfer, and maybe this would finally get rid of business cards. I still don't think that would definitely kill a business card, but there'd have to be a lot of work on it. So you're not, you know, Because then, you know, like the president of the United States wouldn't be able to wear an Apple Watch because they can't have data just pass through like that.
Yeah, it seems like it'd be something that both, or at least the person sending the data, would have to initiate, and then maybe the person receiving the data would have to accept or something. It seems like kind of a weird thing to do through that. I mean, Apple can sell anything, so they might be the ones who can say, oh yeah, this is really cool, and they might come up with a really neat use case like that. But it's definitely not something obvious that everyone's expecting them to do, so they might hold off for another version or two if they're going to do that.
Yeah, so let's move on from there. They said that they have a release date. It won't be till next year. I'm guessing, when did the release date on the first Apple Watch, was that March?
I think they said it was March or April. We had to wait till April 24th to buy it.
Yeah, but I'm thinking it's around the same time that the first generation Apple Watch came out. Because that's what they like to do.
They'll try to have it on the same cycle. They like to be very kind of predictable in when they announce things. And so whenever they announced it last year is probably when they'll announce it this year. And then they may not. They may do the same kind of 6 month lead time, or they might just wait for the next event and try to shift it so that they're not saying, hey, Apple Watch 2 coming in 6 months.
Yeah.
Cause that would kind of kill a lot of the current Apple Watch sales as well.
Oh yeah. And they want to sell as much stock, for Christmas. So they have a limited stock. So they're getting ready for that. So that makes sense. There's another thing that I wanted to touch on base here, and that's this, independence part. And it basically says, alongside new features, more clock faces and a time travel function, it also makes the Apple Watch far more independent from a paired iPhone. And the tetherless is an initiative to make the Apple Watch less reliant on the Bluetooth connection on the iPhone. So it doesn't mean that you can use your Apple Watch with the Android device, although there's ways to do that. And it's not like they're saying, okay, here's, take your Apple Watch and hook it up to an Android device. It's just saying that it's going to be less reliant on what the iPhone is is going through. So you can, when your watch dies on a battery, your phone's not dead on its battery as well. So
yeah,
correct me if I'm wrong.
I would guess it'll be similar to the Android Wear stuff where it has a Wi-Fi radio in it so that even if you're away from your phone, you can still get notifications and potentially phone calls with Wi-Fi calling and you know, lots of other stuff that you can get without needing the Bluetooth connection to the device. So
yeah,
that's and what I would expect.
And the other part was the find my phone or find my watch part. The little chip in there that'll try and connect to some sort of Wi-Fi. So you know, just like with your phone, you'll if you lose it, you'll be able to find it. Especially, you know, if it was like 5-6 years ago, we'd probably have some sort of open SSID somewhere, and then the watch could just, you know, you could find it easily. But maybe there's going to be a way where it wouldn't make much sense. If there was a way that it could attach to somebody else's iPhone to kind of send a signal, but once again, that's a security issue, and we wouldn't be able to get into that. So. And then of course the other rumor, 3D touch. What are your thoughts? Does the Apple Watch need 3D touch?
Probably it actually does, because it has so few input mechanisms on it that having a way to do alternate actions on the same screen, you know, without needing an additional button. So 3D touch would make a lot of sense to me. I would guess that one's coming.
Okay. Yeah. And I guess it does. I haven't really played too much with the new iPhone, the 6S. I went in the store for like 10 minutes and pushed on the screen. That's basically my extent of knowing what the new Apple iPhone does. Have you played with it at all, Luke, at all?
No, I don't even know who at work has gotten them. I was out that Friday that everybody was getting those, and so I think I missed everybody bringing them in, and then now it's just back to, yep, everybody's got a phone. And,
yeah. It's not bad. It's kind of cool. It made me think, well, what do I have to do to upgrade my phone, which right now it's something like $400 to do the upgrade. I'm not going to do that. I'll just wait a little while. So last part that we want to touch on base with the Apple Watch 2 is the rumor for added sensors. Which makes perfect sense. The more sensors that you have into the watch, the better that the watch can perform, and the more data that it can pull from there. And you know, that's data's king, and that's the bottom line right there. Is if you own the data and you know what to do with it, you can control the world. Maybe some of the sensors will go into the band a little bit. But right now they're just, you know, it'll be improved sensors, and that's pretty much a given right there. So,
yeah. Yeah.
So, all right. Anything else you wanted to talk about in this part?
No, I think it's good. I mean, yeah, it could get a better screen. It could get a better design. I'm sure they'll change it up a little bit. Or maybe not. Maybe they'll leave it the same and do it every 2 years, kind of like they do the phone.
Yeah,
where they don't change the form factor right away because they want all the bands that you bought to not be immediately incompatible with the next version. So
exactly.
So, you know, so I could see them changing the design a little bit, but maybe they'll try to keep the bands compatible for one more year.
Yeah, I'm glad that that's what they did with the iPhone 6S, because apparently I might be wrong, but my understanding is the body is the exact same body. So this is the Alo case. For the Alo camera clip thing for the fisheye lens and stuff like that. If I did get a 6S, I could use this case for that. So I'm really happy about that. And of course, the 6S Plus would change everything, but I'm not going to get a 6S Plus because it's too big of a phone for me. But I'm glad that they're going to do that. One last thing, prices. Usually when it comes to stuff like that, the prices stay pretty much the same unless there's some major improvement. So I don't see a major improvement there.
Nah, probably not. Probably going to hold that price point.
Yeah, definitely. So, all right. Well, that does it for this edition of Big News, Little Arms. You like doing that, don't you?
I feel like I'm getting good at it.
Yeah. Well, that's cool. So I got the wrong one. Let's do that. There we go. I always mess that up. All right. Well, you know, hey, first of all, let's do this. Let's talk, because I forgot to talk about our sponsors. And our first big sponsor is our friends over at CashFly, which take care of our RSS bandwidth. So if you watch this on iTunes, which a lot of people might have, You'll see that that you know you or I'm sorry if you see this on YouTube, then you don't worry about it. But CacheFly actually takes care of our RSS bandwidth, so we can put it up on iTunes, so we can put it up on Stitcher, so we can put it up on the podcatchers, so you can download it with your favorite podcast and find out all the cool stuff about wearable technology. So CacheFly, if you go over to CacheFly.com, you can find out more. You can, if you're a podcaster, find out how you can get a couple terabytes free on their 14-day free trial. And of course, if you want a lightning fast CDN, because let's face it, if people aren't watching content within the first few seconds, and this is a problem I'm noticing on Facebook, is the videos, there's so many people are posting videos up on Facebook that their CDN is not keeping up with it. So you start watching some funny video and like within 3 seconds, it starts to buffer. And so you got to wait and you got to wait. If you're on CacheFly, I don't think I've seen one of my videos start to buffer like that. It's great. It's awesome stuff. So check it out over at CacheFly, CacheFly.com for that. And of course, we are a proud partner of the Maker Max Studio because, you know, we're big into Disney. So, and of course, MakerMax.maker.com. You can be a partner on YouTube, which they'll help you with, landing more offers, landing more revenues. If you're a content creator, check it out over at max.maker.com. And when it comes to partner networks for YouTube, I get very picky, and there's been a lot of them that I've looked through, and there's a lot of reasons why I went with Maker. I think that I believe in Maker. So this show's a part of Maker Max. So check it all out. And of course, we're over on many different platforms through that system. So check it all out. And of course, you don't notice the difference. You go to YouTube.com go to Wearable Today. You'll see just the Wearable Today stuff. But if you're a content creator, podcaster, check it all out over there. So, and of course, wearabletoday.com/deals. This is an Amazon page, of course, but you know, if you're looking for a great deal on wearable technology, go over to wearabletoday.com/deals and get yourself the Motorola Motor 360. It's at $121. Last week it was $101. So it goes up and down. So you can find your favorite wearable technology and go from there. You can even check out some of the books like this, Wearable Sensors, by Edward Sazonov and Michael Newman. So you can read a little bit more about the sensors, about the revolution of wearable, and some of the cool stuff like this one right here, the Misfit Flash. I'm a big fan of that one, and it's at a great price, under $15. So, I hate to say it, but you know, the holidays are coming up, and what to get your white loved ones? Why not a wearable? What do you want for Christmas?
Ooh. There's probably several things, but
wearable wise, what do you want for Christmas? there was a theme here. Did you?
I understand. I'm thinking about a bunch of different wearable tech as far as like, would a better fitness tracker, because you know, all the smartwatches all have some amount of fitness tracking in them, but, is that good enough? It's like, it's probably good enough for as much fitness as I'm doing. But maybe there's some better ones to get.
Yeah.
That's probably where I'm at right now, is looking more on that side.
Cool. Cool. Well, you know, you can get it over at wearabletoday.com/deals. It's over.
I'll definitely have to tell people about that.
Over there. Wearabletoday.com/deals. Check it all out and go from there. All right. Let's move on from there. Let's get into our main subject for today. Let me just switch over here. There we go. Is your cat fat? Okay. Gone are the days.
I don't have a cat.
Well, I know you don't have. You have a bird. Is your bird fat?
No. Even fat birds don't weigh very much, but they're not fat.
Well, you know, Gone are the days of lasagna eating cats, as their owners are now adding technology.
Doesn't look like it.
No, it doesn't. Yeah, that's an interesting picture. But owners are now adding technology to your pets' ankles, wrists, whatever. Fitbit CEO James Park said in a Code Mobile conference that they've not only seen kids wear the devices, which he says you should really be 13 or above to be wearing a Weartech device, but they see a lot of weird accounts where the person is only 2 feet tall because they can read that type of stuff and weighs only 20 pounds. And once you start to look at the profile, you know, as Fluffy that owns the Fitbit or whatever. So it's very interesting. It's very short, but it definitely brings us to the topic. And there are wearables for pets. And most of the wearables that we've seen so far are tracking wearables, you know, collars that, you know, send out a GPS signal if Fluffy gets lost and you can find them. But what kind of information can you put on a pet to make them lose weight? Because first of all, they'd have to understand that they need to walk 10,000 steps a day. And you know, if you're not noticing that your cat is fat, then, and you need a wearable to kind of tell you that, then maybe there's something that you need to, I don't know. It doesn't make much sense to me, but a lot of people do it. Some people probably do it just to see, well, can the cat really, wear a wearable, Weartech device and go from there. But do you think that there's going to be any type of market for your pet to have something like that?
Oh, I think there's a huge market for it. I don't understand it. I don't understand why it's so popular. I'll never forget an article. I didn't really like read it. I kind of skimmed it. It was at least a year ago now. And it was the top 10 dog fitness trackers.
Okay.
It was the top 10, which tells you that, are there more than 10 of them out there? How many of these different types of devices for tracking your dog's activity are there? It seems like maybe there are plenty. And I think a lot of them, probably if I went back and found that article, you'd find some of those that either gotten bought by others or just have, you know, kind of died because they didn't have enough funding to keep everything active, and so they can't sell them anymore. They weren't popular enough to get a second run of them, or their Kickstarter didn't fully back or something.
But
do I believe there's a market? Yes, because there is one. And people, I mean, I understand people saying, well, I thought my dog was kind of active during the day, especially if you have an outdoor dog, as we used to call them, where the dog lives outside during the day and, you know, not in the house. You would think that they, you know, maybe people would be like, I want to kind of know how active they're being, so I know how much food to give them each night. So if they're sleeping most of the day because it's cold or it's hot, maybe I don't give them as much food because, you know, they'll get overweight if they eat too much. But, you know, so I can understand people kind of wanting to know so they can be more proactive. But I guess I don't understand, like, necessarily like the extent that we've gotten to now.
Okay. Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, I'm right now I'm trying to look for a still frame of Astro, the dog from the Jetsons. And I think there's been a couple times where he looks at his watch and I'm thinking, well, that's perfect for Astro simply because of the fact that, you know, Astro actually talked. So Scooby-Doo, Astro, which are all fictional characters, they'd be perfect for a wearable. Yeah, they are fictional characters, trust me. But they'd be perfect for a wearable technology. But your dog is not going to know that it does 10,000 steps. And if you don't realize that your dog's doing 10,000 steps, or your cat's doing 10,000 steps, or your bird needs to get out of its cage, I think that's more of an owner issue, because, you know, the pet's not going to care. If they're going to lounge around, they're going to lounge around. And if you think that they're gaining weight, then you need to actually interact with the pet to make them so they start losing weight and feed them less. So, there are some advantages to that. Like I can think of, you know, when it comes to something like cattle or horses or something like that, where you do pay attention to them, but they're, for the most part, they're outside or something like that. You could have something that could check their body temperature, so they're not getting too cold or anything like that. But if they're just getting big because you don't give them anything to exercise with, then once again, it's not, the pet can't do anything about it. You've got to do something about it. And putting a wearable on them for that is just ridiculous.
Yeah, it seems like you can. Yeah, if your pet is being lethargic, you know, not feeling well, most owners, pet parents, as they often go by, are pretty tuned to figuring out, okay, I know this animal pretty well. I can tell that it's not feeling well, or it looks a little chunky. Let me get on the scale with it and kind of see how much it weighs, you know, do some rough things, maybe take it by the vet and say, hey, can you just do a checkup and see like how, you know, what do you think? You know, you've seen a lot of animals, like is my dog sick? Those kinds of things. Now, there's another whole aspect of this that we haven't touched on yet, which is tracking. So there are GPS trackers, there are Bluetooth trackers, there are lots of different types of trackers for animals. That's a whole different kind of story, because that comes into, you know, how well can you find your dog? Let's say it runs off and, you know, maybe it's known to do that, or you've got a big piece of property and you kind of let your cat roam around and, you know, like you're like, is the cat still here? Is it okay? That kind of thing. I want to be alerted if it ever leaves the premises or something, those kinds of things. Like maybe there's a little bit more use there because you would, you know, it's a little harder for you to observe.
Yeah.
That kind of thing.
There's this one over on wearable.com where they show some of the pet wearables. One of them, GoPro Fetch, that's, you know, just to take video from them. We have the Fitbark, which is track their every move. That's a GPS tracker. The Whistle Activity Monitor, syncs with the smartphone to alert you of any changes in activity levels. So I suppose you could put goals on or something like that. But once again, that's for you. The Stick and Find, which of course is looks like something you can all, it's just a tracker. And then voice, which this might be actually cool. I think if this is what I'm thinking it does, voice becomes familiar with your dog's stats. It starts to offer tips tailored to its specific needs. So, and then of course, like I said, for bigger pets or animals like cows or horses or something like that, we had the Silent Herdsman, which looks like something that, you know, because you're not seeing them. They're not roaming around the house like a cat or dog would. They're out in the barn. So unless you do have your cow just roaming around the house, then go for it. So
yes, like there's probably somebody out there, but I doubt somebody with 100 head of cattle that's letting them roam around their house.
Yeah.
But those, in those kind of situations, I mean, so I'm from Texas and I'm going to say the words cattle rustling, but you know, it is a known issue, right? I mean, those cows go for, you know, thousands of dollars when they're sold.
Yeah.
So if somebody can load up a trailer with, you know, four or five cows, hey, we just, you know, that's a lot of money. So, I mean, that's why they brand cattle, you know, so putting GPS trackers on something that, you know, is your livelihood like that makes a lot of sense to me. And even maybe the activity tracking of like, hey, these cows are supposed to be getting, you know, some exercise. Like we need them to build up their muscle. And if they're just laying around all day, that may not be what's best for them. So,
are you saying that instead of branding a cow or horse, they just put a GPS tracker in them? I mean, I don't know if that'd be more humane or less humane. You know, could that, replace branding in itself.
It probably could. I don't know if I'd question which is easier to remove or hide. If you were going to sell it, like, a brand might be a lot harder to hide than removing a GPS tracker.
That's true.
So now if they could, and maybe they already do this. I honestly am not a cattle farmer, so I'm not sure, but you would think that they could chip them and it might be the best of both. Like, they could chip them so that they're identifiable, and then they could GPS tag them so they can monitor them. And, you know, of course, the GPS trackers can be made so that if they remove the GPS tracker, now it sets off, you know, alarms and notifies everybody and stuff. Because, you know, obviously somebody's trying to stop the ability of you to track them at that point. So there's definitely something wrong. Or the cow has knocked it off or something, you know, like that. There's some sort of issue. So, that kind of situation, it makes a lot more sense to me.
You haven't seen Jurassic World yet, have you?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you did. Yeah. So it's kind of like that scene. Spoiler alert. End of the summer. It's now on DVD. If you haven't seen it now, you should go see it. Spoiler. It actually was in the commercials, too. The one synthetic dinosaur actually dug out the sensor that was implanted in their back or something like that.
Like the GPS tracker or whatever. Yeah. They clawed it out.
Yeah. So I don't know if a cow or a horse could do that, but, you know, that's something to think about. One more thing here. I just saw on Wearable, and this is kind of funny. This one right here. No more woof. Want your dog to be able to speak via your special collar? Excuse me, like Doug in Disney film Up? Or, of course you do. It's still a prototype stage. No more woof combines the EEG sensoring microcomputer and special BCI software reader to work out a man's best friend is thinking using an onboard Raspberry Pi computer. There you go. Now, that's smart. And you know, at first when I saw that, I thought it was like a shock collar. Because we had a dog that was
barking, right?
Yeah, we had a dog that when I was living with some other people, they had a dog that they got from a farm, and the dog had a problem with barking, and it came with a shock collar. And yes, we did try the shock collar out. I'm just going to say that.
Everybody does.
Years ago. But the whole point is, actually, it was a couple of years ago. The whole point is, sorry, I got a little tick here. But anyway, the whole point is that I'm not a big fan of the shock collar, but this is actually pretty cool. I don't know, could we figure out what Rover is thinking? Squirrel? I don't know.
Probably. I'm hungry and I love you. Hungry.
Squirrel.
I'm hungry. I love you. I'm hungry. You know, like that's what I imagine dogs are thinking, because they seem to either want food from you, or they want to say how much they love you. So
what do you think Birdie is thinking? Well, besides get me out of this freaking cage, what do you think Birdie's thinking?
Right now, Birdie's like, I want out. That's pretty much most of what she's thinking. And
but
you've got food.
Yeah, that's true. But more of the question is she thinking, I want out because you're in the other room, or why are you punishing me? I want out.
Oh.
So I guess
did I do wrong?
Yeah, what did I do wrong, as opposed to I don't like being here? Those are technically two different things right there. So does Birdie think that she's getting punished right now?
I don't know about right now. I think she is saying she really wants out. And so I don't know if she feels like she's being punished. She might feel like, or she probably feels like she's being mistreated. You know, like, hey, I should be out. You should be letting me out. Why aren't you letting me out? You're being mean to me.
Yeah.
I don't know if she would see it as like you're punishing me for doing something wrong. I think that.
Yeah.
I don't know if she would see that. I know she has felt that way. Like I think she's felt that way before.
Okay.
I shouldn't say no.
So, but you know, if she was out, she'd just be attacking your hat, apparently. So.
She would, she'd either be running in fear from it or attacking it, you know, fight or flight.
Okay.
She can actually fly. So
next week we're going to find out, as Luke wears the hat and Birdie's going to be here.
we shall see.
Okay.
We shall see.
Okay. Well, in the meantime, you know, what do you like my six pack abs right here?
That's the quickest way to get six pack abs.
Yes.
I think bar none.
And then of course,
6 second abs, you know, you put the shirt on, abs.
There you go. And then of course the cool cape right there. So
cape's nice. Although I couldn't find any example of a Batman throughout the lore of Batman where he actually wore a yellow cape.
How about a lore of Batman where he was bald and had a goatee?
I think there might be some of those in later ones. It's hard to tell because a lot of them he's always wearing a little cowl. So
how about bald, has a goatee, and about 50 pounds overweight?
Batman does stay in shape pretty well, so he can be muscle, so he might be heavy, but probably not overweight in the traditional sense
of the word. So that's me. I'm the bald, bearded, overweight Batman.
Well, I couldn't pull off Batman either, but for kind of the opposite reason. Too skinny and scrawny.
Yeah. But the best part is you do pull off Luke Skywalker. All right. Well, Luke, tell everybody where they can find you.
That's weird.
It is weird.
You can find me on Twitter, Luke Luca. But if it wasn't weird, we wouldn't do it. That's the best way to reach me. Just send me your hash browns or whatever it is people do on Twitter, and I'll tweet you back, and we'll give you a shout out. If you've got any comments or have any ideas of what my costume for this year is, which I've been able to keep a secret from a lot of people, you might tweet me that, or you can find me on Google Plus, or obviously here, Luke at wearabletoday.com.
Or in the new movie coming out in December.
Oh yeah. That should be pretty good.
Yeah, it should be pretty good. Should be very good. And of course, I don't tweet, but Robin does tweet. Get it?
Yes, Robin.
So anyway, you can find me over at Geekazine, Think Magazine, Put in a Geek. Geekazine.com, plus.google.com/plusgeekazine. You know your routine, the whole thing. And let me see if I can do I look like that?
Yeah, you gotta get bigger crazy eyes.
Okay. All right. Well,
if you're listening to the audio, this is probably not as entertaining as if you're watching the video. So.
Yeah, you got to watch the video on this because you don't see the Batman and you don't see the Luke Skywalker. So, anyway, that does it for this episode of Wearable Today. A shorter show, but hey it works. And of course, show notes upcoming next week. We will have a show. And then 2 weeks from today, I will be in Las Vegas. And that will be the last week of October. So we'll definitely have our Halloween blowout show, and we'll talk a lot about wearable tech and Halloween next week. So tune in. That'll be really cool. And then go from there. So thank you very much, Luke, for being part of the show. Sorry, Birdie, that apologize to Birdie for me for having her locked in her cage. And we heard the cries all during the show. So you all know. And thanks a lot for watching. Thanks a lot for listening. We will see you next week. You guys geek out and take care. This has been episode number 86 of Wearable Today. Were you going to say something, Luke? Okay. Now you got to say something. Stop shaking your head. Say bye.
Bye, everybody.
There you go.
See you next week.
Okay.
On Wearable Today.
Here.
.com.